I'm Maren Hansen, and I teach at Pacifica Graduate Institute. I've taught in the humanities program in a variety of courses over the years, and was involved in the initial shaping of the Engaged Humanities program at Pacifica.
And I'm Susan Rowland. I'm the current chair of the humanities program, and I'm delighted to have taken on what Maren has helped set up, that's such a rich program.
Susan, can you talk a little bit about what you feel is really special and unique about this particular humanities program, graduate humanities program, and also what draws students to this program?
Well, I think they are drawn by the fact it is unique. I don't think there's another humanities program in the world that combines depth psychology, which is the psychology of the creative imagination, with the humanities, those disciplines that have grown over the centuries, looking at what makes us human. Some humanities disciplines have been with us for thousands of years, like philosophy. Some are relatively new, like literary and film studies, but they're all focused on our humanity. Depth psychology, another kind of new disciplinary area, is really looking at enlivening the soul, enlivening the psyche. Combine that with humanities, you get something that is very special and very dynamic. Thirdly, we have the wonderful ingredient of creative practice. It's the third pillar on the program. It's part of all our courses. And that combination of exploring the humanities in an engaged way, in so that we look at creative practices as also learning practices, with the depth psychology, it makes the whole thing very much alive, very dynamic, and very kind of self-sustaining and nurturing for the students. So we get three broad groups of students, and that doesn't exclude, you know, people coming for other reasons, but students come to the program very often because they are artists or creatives and they want to deepen their practice. They want to take it to another level. And they find that in this combination of humanities, depth psychology, and creative practice. Or they come because they are interested in the humanities themselves, but they're looking for something different from the programs that they find in traditional universities. Strong programs in many cases, but there is a problem with the humanities becoming rather dry and abstract.
Well, I'd like to ask you a little bit, talk a little bit more about that. The program is titled Engaged Humanities, and you referred to that a minute ago. Can you tell me more about engaged with what? What does the engaged part mean?
Well, it means engaged with the soul, engaged with the psyche, and engaged with the world. And of course, all learning ought to be engaged with the psyche and engaged with the world.
Yes.
However, we've developed a very complex society, and we've divided up learning into different disciplines with different starting points and different rules. And the result has been that many of the humanities have become programs that start and appear to be somewhat distanced from real life. And so that philosophy and the study of arts and literature and culture and mythology is often taken to be somehow abstract and not important to actually how we live our lives and how we see our lives and how we contribute to the world. And the humanities was never like that. Traditionally, if you go back centuries, humanities were about how to be a good citizen. mm-hmm. or how to be a moral person, how to live the good life, how to contribute to your world. So this program is on the one hand really new because it has this combination of humanities, depth psychology and creativity, mm-hmm. but it's new in the service of what is deeply important and powerful about the humanities, that they are actually very practical subjects because they are about how to negotiate the world, how to live your life, how to contribute something unique or something new to your society.
I recently heard you say in a speech that you gave at graduation that you feel that the humanities is more important to study now than ever before, that there's something ultimately practical about studying the humanities at this point in our history. Can you speak to that?
Yes, I can. I think that the program addresses in a very powerful and concrete way major problems of our time that are paralyzing people and making them sick, to be honest. I think that we're all affected by the two big problems that we face, which is climate change and mm-hmm. what we call terrorism, the threat of violence in our society. And we've seen, tragically, recent examples of violence and realize yet again that it could happen anywhere, anytime to any of us. Mm. So even though we may never, in fact, experience an act of terrorism very personally, we fear it. Mm-hmm. So we're living more and more with this climate of fear. And with climate change, we know that it's starting to affect us. We know that it will affect our children and grandchildren. And we feel powerless to do anything about it. Mm-hmm. So these problems are too big for the individual. And yet we know that they deeply affect our lives and what we hope for the future and for our children. Now, C.G. Jung was very interested in what he saw, the kind of fragile and sick psyche of modern times. And he felt that this was caused by the repression of our fears and that the growth of our fears because we couldn't deal with our fears. He noticed that when people came to him for psychotherapy, they felt they were stuck in their lives. Mm-hmm. And I feel that, you know, many people come to feel that they're stuck in their lives in certain aspects of them. But in a way, we're all stuck with climate change. We're all stuck with the fear of violence. Truly. And Jung noticed that, you know, that this theme of stuckness was not only at the heart of his psychotherapy, it was the heart of fairy tale and myth, and that's a quotation from him. And if you like, fairy tales and myth are the beginnings of humanities. Humanities are the legacy of fairy tales and myths that are very simple, ancient ways of becoming unstuck, of dealing with things that are too big for us as individuals, as too big for us to be rational about, that we have these resources in the humanities, in creativity itself, and in now in the psychology of the creative imagination, to deal with the ways in which we feel paralyzed by fear, and to deal with them creatively, to start to reach out to other people, to start to be part of the solution rather than being part of the problem.
I feel that one of the things that our humanities program offers students is an immersion in interdisciplinary thinking, in deep thinking, depth thinking, how to access the intelligence of the unconscious. Creative practices that really open us to the new. And we're desperately in need of the new in our world now, of new solutions, new paradigms. The old paradigms are not serving us well anymore.
Yes, and you have a wonderful phrase for this. It was you who said to me that the program develops the multisensory imagination. And I think that's so important because obviously, you know, imagination is a good thing, and many programs will speak to it, but they don't have this combination of with the depth psychology, multiple techniques for developing the imagination. Things like active imagination, things like reverie, working with images, working with the body. And then when you combine that with traditional creative practices, or rather you enliven and develop traditional creative practices, so that you write poetry in a new way because you know how to work with images at a very deep way, that you can think differently about your work as a visual artist because you have a sense of the archetypes and how they've worked in mythology and history and how they touch very deep sources within ourselves doing the program, but also within those whom we take the material of the program to.
I think that the students of the humanities program come out of the program with a cultivated perspective, a very unique cultivated depth perspective that, in my opinion, is the difference that makes all the difference. I mean, that the quality of the thinking of our students is so enriched by the unconscious, by the imagination, by moving across disciplines, by the insights of depth psychology. And one of the questions many people ask about the humanities program is, what kind of employment opportunities does it lead toward? And my reflection about that is that as an employer, you can't train that cultivated perspective. I mean, that is hugely valuable to have an employee who can think in those deep, cross-disciplinary, creative ways. And you can train somebody to in a particular skill, but having a broadly educated perspective and good critical thinking, I think is enormously valuable.
And it's something, you're right, it is something you can't train. You can only educate for that. You know, it takes education to develop this combination of critical thinking with imaginal thinking and deep imagination. And again, what's important about the program is that it gives the student the confidence of being that type of person. Because we do so much, we do so many different skills drawn from the different disciplines, and we do it all in a kind of imaginal, holistic way, students develop their own voice. They develop their own authority even. And it's not an authority of trying to boss people about. It's an authority of knowing that they've got different skills to access and different qualities that will rise to different occasions and can look at things in more than one way. And that is, that can't be trained. It can only be educated. But it's a wonderful quality for any employee to have. And the students have gone on to a variety of careers. They've gone on to good jobs in marketing, in advertising, the archetypal sense being incredibly valuable there. They've gone on to work in film and TV. A lot of them are interested in doing teaching and have develop skills into various types of teaching at different levels. There's a whole kind of growth area in what's sometimes called the creative industries. That they did a survey recently that said that 25% of new jobs in the 21st century would be in the creative industries, which means that they need people with a certain creative outlook. And again, something that you don't get from a lot of kind of straightforward traditional educations, but that is very much part of the Engaged Humanities and Creative Life program. So the students have found themselves highly employable for these new creative areas to do with, sometimes they're to do with new media, technology, working now in social media, which is a huge growth area for business opportunities. And they need people who have a sense of the whole person, who have a sense of being able to be intuitive. That's hugely important with working with new technology and its interface with people. And people who have an ingrained strength because they've learned to use all these underdeveloped qualities in this very thorough and diverse and imaginative education.
I think we got sidetracked a little bit earlier when you were starting to tell about what draws students to the program. And I think you mentioned the first point was people who have a creative interest.
Yes.
And do you want to continue with that?
Yeah, and I said secondly, people who were looking for a different type of humanities education, who perhaps had a traditional done a traditional humanities degree, perhaps in one discipline or a major and a minor, and were looking for something to kind of go beyond that, to have that interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary quality, so that they could have a more diverse and rounded education, perhaps because they were going to sort of teach in different ways in the future. There is a third group of people who are really interesting students, and these are people who are looking to make a new start in life. People who want to make a major change, perhaps they want to change their career. They don't really know what to do, but they know they don't want to go on doing what they have been doing for the last 20 years. They want to do something different. And so they come looking for something different, and they're also looking for themselves. You know, they are looking to find those parts of themselves that they may have lost sight of, or they may feel that they've never had a chance to be. And you know, this is a wonderfully practical degree. It really does give you qualities and skills and insights and intuitions to take into the world and do things and be part of the world of work and vocation. But it does so in a way that supports self-development and personal transformation. So I think we can all imagine places and courses that are about changing yourself. But this is a course in which, this is a program in which changing yourself is part of an education that is also a practical education for the world. And that's one of the things that's very magical about it, that students, all the students find their own voice. They find their own strength because they found their own creativity. And they found that they can be critical, they can think for themselves, they can develop insights, they can have vision, they can develop their own vision and perspectives because they've learned to work very deeply with the unconscious, with the psyche, with the soul, and to explore parts of themselves that haven't been explored before, mm-hmm. in a very safe way, in a very congenial way, to make friendships through doing this. But all the while, they are on their own kind of quest, their own kind of discovery, discovery of themselves, but also discovery of the beautiful and creative resources in the world. A lot of young people, after they've done their first degree, will go on and do a Master of Fine Arts in creative writing or in painting or sculpture or in filmmaking, in these different areas. These graduate programs are really popular. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, obviously they offer some really valuable training. They do a good job. However, the majority of students going into those programs are not going to make it as a successful artist or the next Hollywood director. Mm-hmm. What they need is a way of sustaining their interest in creativity. They need to have what these programs don't provide. These programs don't provide inner strength. They don't provide the kinds of multidisciplinary multisensory training in the imagination. They're very much focused on a particular market for a particular creative practice, like getting your novel published or getting your painting into a gallery. Mm-hmm. And those are important things, you know, if you want to be a novelist or if you want to get your painting into a gallery. But how do you survive when you don't get your novel published in the first 5 years? Or the galleries don't want to take your art? How do you deal with rejection? How do you deal with the fact that the world isn't what your teachers hoped it would be for you when you were in high school, when you were in your first degree?
Okay, so how does the Engaged Humanities program equip you for that?
It equips you for that because it equips you for life, basically. It equips you to be strong, to understand what's going on a bigger level. It equips you to understand the way the world works, the way the world is harsh, and the way the world is going to throw things at you that you're not prepared for. And that's where the depth psychology comes in, and we look at things like the shadow, and the way the shadow for the creative person comes in many ways. It comes in creative blocks. It comes in a sense of failure. It comes in other people telling you you're no good. It comes in not making enough money to sustain your life or your family. It comes in being forced to do other things. But these are the shadow, and this can become the ingredients for your own power. It can mm-hmm. become the ingredients for your own really unique creativity, which actually only comes if you know how to engage with the shadow, if you know how to work with the mm-hmm. shadow, mm-hmm. if you know how to make the darkness a root for your life and work, not something that stops your life and work. I think at least half the students who go into Masters of Fine Arts programs would be better off coming here to Engaged Humanities and the Creative Life, because we offer a supportive, nurturing environment where you can explore your own creativity, where it's safe to fail, and where we take all the instances of the shadow and we explore how to work with them, how to make the darkness a source for your life in the future. To a certain extent, as a creative person, if you are trying to make a living by it, you are very dependent and helpless. And, you know, we can't necessarily change the creative markets, but we can certainly educate people not to feel helpless, to feel to know, to have opportunities, know how to go out and create their own life mm-hmm. that is going to be a sustainable, healthy and happy life mm-hmm. and that is going to be able to work positively with what any creative person faces.
The Humanities Program creates an opportunity for people to be deeply rooted psychologically.
Yes.
The format of the cohort and the teachings yeah. of depth psychology so encourage people to deeply explore yeah. themselves.
Yeah.
So people mature into a really deepened understanding of self.
Mm.
And I liked what you said earlier about how they really acquire their authentic voice
yes.
In the world.
Mm.
And then I think in addition to that, the teachings of depth psychology and the practices of active imagination particularly help people learn how to harvest the intelligence of the unconscious so that maybe I wrote short stories or I was a good screenwriter before I came into the program, but knowing how to harvest the images from your dreams and that to gain access to the archetypal patterns of the unconscious is an enormous asset in any career, but particularly in creative careers. And I think that's another way in which people who come into the humanities program become deeply psychologically rooted.
Yes, absolutely. And again, it's the fact that this is an education that enables this to happen, that some of these benefits of having that rootedness in the archetypes can happen through that type of therapy, but not in the way in which it's united with an education in these different disciplines, mm-hmm. in these different ways of addressing the world and contributing to the world. So that there's a sense in which we do, we kind of are doing a number of different things that contribute to developing and strengthening the person who can then offer the benefits of this rootedness in the archetypal imagination in so many different ways to the world beyond.
I think that the motto of Pacifica really sums this up.
Mm.
Do you want to say it?
No, you have to say it.
Anima mundi calende gratia. For
the sake of tending the soul of the world.
Yes.
Yes. We've mentioned it, and it's the use of active imagination for creative practices.
Mm-hmm.
Because active imagination was developed by C.G. Jung as a therapy. And it's discussed in the collected works very much in a therapeutic context. Whereas it's so important for creative people as part of the creative process to develop their imagination in this very, I haven't got the right words, but this very kind of, I want to say systematic, but it sounds too cold, that active imagination develops a level of psychological reality that is vital, literally vital, as in vitalizing for creative practice. It's something that develops the creative writer in creating characters and stories. It's something that takes visual art to a new level. The ability to work with images and ultimately have the images work on you.
Yes.
This is something that is basic to active imagination that's been developed in the Jungian world. It's not taught this way, this powerful way in any arts education. Mm-hmm. And by doing it on the program, we are offering something very special to people who are engaged in creative practice. Mm-hmm. We're developing another aspect of depth psychology, which is depth psychology that goes into something that is beyond the therapeutic, or perhaps is taking the therapeutic into a larger definition of their therapeutic. Mm-hmm. So that Pacifica's motto, for the sake of tending the soul of the world, here it's very practical. You know, by doing things like active imagination with the students, they are literally developing the soul of the world through their creative practice. And that's unique, because active imagination and creative practice is woefully underdeveloped. And it's something that this program is pioneering.
I think a lot of people are familiar with the anecdotes about, you know, how Einstein made certain discoveries based on a dream, or Edison made certain discoveries based on a dream, and that much of the innovative thinking that's gone on in human history has come from images from the unconscious.
Absolutely.
And I think anybody who is interested in working toward innovative solutions to problems in our world would do well to learn how to harvest and interact with the intelligence of the unconscious, of the imagination. And so I find that a deeply important part of the humanities program, that students really learn that practice of the active imagination, how to engage the unconscious, to listen to what I call the fertile new.
Yes.
We are so in need of the new, that the humanities roots back into the earliest thinking of the human species. So we're rooted in age-old ideas and wisdom, and yet in doing the practices of imagination and engaging with the unconscious, out of those deep old roots comes the innovative and the new.
Yes.
And I love the holding of those opposites in this program.
Yes. Yeah. And it's very dynamic. It's very exciting. It makes for a wonderful group of people, because they're all doing it for themselves, but they can also support each other. So we get these wonderful dynamic cohorts.